You are now listening to Out of the Blank.
Well, welcome to another episode of Out of the Blank podcast. I'm here with Paul Scholtz.
Hey, how's it going?
Now, Paul, what are you interested in? I had to change up the beginning because I'm always like, what do you do professionally? And I'm like, who the hell wants to keep talking about their job all the time?
I'm interested in a lot of stuff. Basically, mainly just making things. I enjoy building stuff. I enjoy, you know, putting stuff together. Enjoy just expressing myself artistically, but mostly with, you know, just stuff I can do with my hands.
Now, what are we talking about building wise? Because, I mean, I like to build things too, like building the fort. Remember so many times when I was a kid, I used to go out in the back and just pick up sticks. And then, you know, you get string and everything and try and tie everything together. Oh, my God. I don't know how many times I made like the crappiest rundown little fort to the point where my dad was like, you got to take it down, man. It's just we live in like a nice two-story house next to a golf course. Like every other house looks just like ours. It's wonderful. The neighborhood's all together and everybody's complaining about your fort. I'm like, but it has character. And he goes, the character is a sense of shit. I'm just letting you know.
Well, I made my share of forts growing up too. We had I grew up on a ranch, so I would make forts out of the haystacks. I take all the bales of hay and stack them up. More recently, though, I'm really interested in drawing and tabletop gaming, so I make I draw paper miniatures, and I do a lot of stuff with paper crafts, just folding stuff up, making little houses, making little trees. I started doing it about 5 or 6 years ago, and I just really enjoy it.
Is this similar to like Dungeons and Dragons type stuff?
Yeah, it's you know, stuff like I got into gaming about the same time I started getting into paper craft. I'd always kind of tangentially appreciated it as a kid, but you know, just I grew up in a really evangelical background, and it just wasn't really something that you did. But then once I grew up and moved out, I kind of rediscovered it and got back into it.
Now, when we say developing for tabletop games, what specific games are you trying to, do you create your own or do you make up stuff like maybe some things you can add on to Monopoly? I know they have like all those different editions of Monopoly and stuff, you know, Game of Thrones or something like that. People make their own little pieces to it. But like with Dungeons and Dragons, making your own crafts, making your own little miniature figures or getting your own dice collecting, you know, I never played Dungeons and Dragons, but the amount of creation that really goes into it's pretty inspiring.
Oh, for sure. I used to be really into comics, and I kind of realized that I don't like drawing the same thing over and over again, which is kind of essential when you're drawing comics. And I'm like, I like drawing, but I just don't want to draw the same thing over and over again. So that's one of the things I like about gaming is you can draw so many different things, and it never has to be the same. You can really scratch whatever creative itch you want to at any given time. I draw little guys that you can put on your table. Cause I mean, people make the resin miniatures and they sculpt them, which I've done a little bit of that. It just takes so long to do. And painting them is just a whole nother art skill you have to develop, which I've got so many hobbies that I'm already into. I didn't really want to have to invest in all the miniature painting gear, learn how to do a whole nother skill set. And I thought, well, I can already draw, so I can make little paper ones. And
now with the little paper ones, we talking about like the ones that you would see like at like paper mache, or are we talking about like little like folded pieces of paper, kind of the origami style?
Like little stand-ups, like front, just like I'm trying to think of an example.
Like a pop-up book?
No, just you there's a, like you have the front of the guy, and then you have the back of the guy, and you fold it on the seam and glue it together and put it in a little plastic stand or paper stand, and it's like a little mannequin, almost just two dimensional.
Ah, okay. See, because I was always so fascinated with Dungeons and Dragons. I've never played, but there was a game. I don't know if you remember this, called HeroScape.
Oh yeah, I remember HeroScape.
Okay, if you try, anybody looks up HeroScape right now on eBay or anything like that, those board games go for like almost $1,000 on eBay. Like, I didn't know it was that rare. It makes me really pissed off that we ended up having a yard sale and selling it for like $5. But those little miniature figures, which are like, they're now called Hero Clicks, the little guys that have like a circular platform they stand on, they're collectibles. And that was always it for me. Like, it was crazy because whatever collectibles that you had, you could be able to design your game that way and have your own set of team. Like, I remember all the times I used to play against my brother. The cool part about collecting them, or once you start getting them, it's like when you get into a hobby like knife collecting or something. Once you get one, you just keep adding more and more and more.
Mm-hmm.
And when I got my first set, I remember it was Christmas Day. I opened it up, and it was I had three cowboys, and then I had a bunch of robots, and they all came in one starter pack. And I was like, this is the weirdest thing. It's cowboys in future. Like, what? Like, what is this? How am I going to design this game? And then as I'm playing and playing, I started collecting more and more figures. My brother developed his team kind of like an angels and demons type thing. And mine was more of the side of like archers and monks, thing from like Shaolin Dynasty, and monks from like, it looked like they were chilling up in a Tibetan temple or something. And it really shows a lot about a person's character too, by the things that they use.
As I remember when I was in high school and I was playing Magic the Gathering, I would always make a white and blue deck, and my friends are always like, oh, we're playing that's about black decks. These guys are all trying to be so hard to be edgy.
Yeah, see, and that's the thing. Back in school, we had one teacher in like I think it was like sixth grade. He used to have an after school academy where the kids would come in and bring their Yu-Gi-Oh cards. You always knew someone was a badass when they dropped a blue eyes white dragon onto the field. That's when shit got real, we would say.
Oh, for sure.
But when it comes to like designing and stuff, like, what do you typically try and design with? Like, what do you prefer? Like, we talk about doing the same thing over and over again, but you have to have something you prefer to make more than others. I know games can kind of be radical and just the destinations they can take place, but is there a certain thing you try and stick with, such as like creatures or animals, or is there maybe just like a certain type, like superheroes or something, like creative board games? Like HeroClix was really popular with bringing superheroes into the mix. I know they made the whole the Avengers line, and a lot of people just started collecting those because, I mean, damn, you got the Avengers on your team. Like, no one's fucking with you when you got Captain America.
For sure. I typically draw mostly fantasy stuff, but I put a real Wild West kind of bend to it. So I grew up on a ranch. I grew up, my family performed in rodeos. So I've always kind of put a, you know, spaghetti Western. It's like Lord of the Rings, but what if Clint Eastwood in a poncho was walking around in that world?
Yeah. You see, I like it changing up. What always is crazy is that when you get to see people that kind of stick to one basis all the time, I'm like, don't you ever just want to add something new? Like one day space shuttle just crashes and like an alien comes out, and the next thing you know, all these people from the West got to start fighting all these aliens and stuff. I'm similar with the cowboy thing because my grandfather really into Clint Eastwood movies. I mean, and Steven Seagal for some reason. I don't know why, but it's the first thing I got attracted to was just the cowboys. I would always go for like the gunslingers. You get one guy with holding two pistols up. I always had those miniature figures on my field. Mm-hmm. And then I obviously had the monks just because I was really, really interested in like just that culture of medieval history.
Well, like you have a train robbery, but instead of riding up on horses, you got these guys riding up on dragons and they're shooting lightning out of their heads.
Now that is a good story. I would like to hear.
That's a visual right there.
Why can't that be a Steven Seagal movie? If someone were going to create that now, I mean, if you notice, they only shoot Steven Seagal from like the face up because that man has gone completely kind of a 180 from what he used to be.
Well, Steven Seagal did do a train movie in Under Siege 2.
Did they shoot him the whole thing? Like the actual body?
Yeah, the whole thing was the whole thing. Well, mostly. The whole thing was on a train.
Well, mostly. They had a bunch of stunt doubles on there. I didn't notice that. I was just like, oh, there's Steven Seagal. And then I noticed because a lot of people used to talk about how he gained so much weight. And I was like, what is that from? And I figured out that he had a leg injury like way back in the day. But he's that type of guy that we all know that's like the dude from Pawn Stars. It's like, let me get a buddy. I have a buddy that's real an expert on that. You know that he's literally like, they're like, I know he was training cops at one point. Like he was doing a bunch of stuff. And they're like, how do you know anything about military? He's like, oh, I was a cop for 65 years. You're like, you're only 37, dude. Like, what are you talking about? He goes, hey, look at that helicopter up there. He goes, oh yeah, that helicopter. I've been flying jets for probably 46 years. It's like, what are you talking about, man?
Yeah, we always know that guy that always like, yeah, I was with the CIA for 15 years. Like, dude, I've known you your entire life and you never have left town.
There's always that guy that tries to top a story too.
Yep.
So with even with just the papercraft miniatures and all that stuff that you make for role-playing games, like why did you decide specifically to do stuff like this? Like, I mean, it was, I know it's out of boredom or out of kind of like a creative type thing, but I mean, out of so many outlets that you could go towards, such as like woodcrafting and stuff, when did you figure out that this is something that you wanted to stick with? I mean, you're really good at it too. I mean, credit to you. I'm looking at a lot of these things. I see what you're talking about now with the front and the back kind of stand up minifigures, but it's amazing too, because I mean, the amount of time it must take that you have to put in to make one of these things has got to be immense.
It's not too bad. I mean, there's a lot of artists out there that do the same thing that are faster than I am. I'm still kind of, I've only been actually producing them for the last year or so, but I've been making them for a long time. That was the one thing I figured out. I was like, man, I love these miniatures. Cause I'm a lot of people don't like playing D&D with miniatures. They like playing it just the Ear to the Mind, or they're just describing it, which is a perfectly valid way to do it. And it's one,
you gotta have the miniatures. You gotta have the miniatures. I'm sorry. Me, I am a visual learner. I will never get the information unless you're throwing a textbook at me.
Oh, I'm the same. I am the same way. But I mean, I can understand that there are people that's just not their thing. And it does take a little bit extra time, which is fine with it. I for one think it's worth it. But you know, I didn't want to take the time sculpting, because I would sculpt a couple of them, and my gosh, that would take me almost a month just to get a couple done. I'm like, my kids, my first players are my kids, because I live very rural, and I just didn't grow up with anybody that played. I didn't know anybody that played. I kind of had to teach myself to play fourth edition D&D. And so I was like, well, I've got these two people that live in my house that seem eager to play, so I'll just have them be my first players. And it would take a long time, because I'd want to get the right miniature sculpted and have the whole game ready. And then it's like, man, this takes too long. Hey, wait, I can draw. Oh yeah, I can just make these out of paper. And then I looked online, and there's whole community of artists that are making miniatures like this. So I start, you know, spend, you know, $2 on one, $3 on another, and then print them out, and you have a whole table full of miniatures after about an hour. I'm like, this is a lot quicker, and man, they look really good. And so then last year, a couple of the other artists that produce these that I'm friends with, they said, hey man, you've got to just bite the bullet and get into doing this. Like, oh, okay. So yeah.
Well, when it comes to kind of designing your own creatures too, like, do you randomly come up with these inspirations off of things you just see that randomly strike you, and just like you decide like, oh, well, that would be a perfect thing to make. Let's make an orc, or I don't even know how to say this word. I guess orache jelly mega
ochre.
Ochre. Oh my god. Ochre jelly. There's a lot of words in that were silent.
That's true. There's a most of the ones I've done recently, or that I've done so far, have been ones that are already like in the monster manual, ones that people already know. Because, you know, there's a lot of miniatures that have been made, but there are a lot of gaps that haven't been filled. Like, they're like the steel plated bull thing, the Gorgon. Like, nobody has a Gorgon miniature. It's like, man, I know how to draw a bull, so I can do that. Or eventually, I do want to create some of my own. I've got a couple adventures I'm working on. One that I want to make, it's a mechanical dragon that you can pilot around like a mecha, that I want to make a miniature for. But for the most part, I'm sticking to actually published monsters that are already out there that people know, just so, you know, come up with anything too weird with the new guy on the block.
Well, there used to be what's so popular about this, and like just making miniatures, where we have the people that want to play Dungeons and Dragons strictly on creativity and all that, and then there's the visual ones that need the little miniature figures that go with it. It's because everybody's creation level is a little bit different. For me, I can craft out something with an imagination. Like, you know, I always say that people that were very imaginative, such as having imaginary friends as a kid, are able to be the types that can, you know, they don't need any of the miniature figures to play Dungeons and Dragons or something. They can easily just create it in their mind. But for a lot of people, they need to see it. And it creates a better experience and allows them to connect as well. Like, what made HeroScape for me that was so much fun was, I mean, there were terrain pieces. You had to set the scale. You had to set the scene. I mean, we live in a world now where technology can do all that for us. Like, it at your fingertips, somebody can literally create a whole entire map or create whatever they want in front of them, you know, be able to see it. It's way different compared to back in the day when we had to literally think it up and then try and, you know, imagine it in our mind just to be able to see it.
Oh, sure.
But I think where it kind of gets popular, first of all, with Dungeons and Dragons, is the whole idea is there's a fantasy aspect I think a lot of people really enjoy. And you probably notice this just with creating it yourself, how much fun that you're having with your kids. I mean, oh, this, like when I first stumbled across your page, immediately I was like, this guy has like, he understands it, mostly because like you're doing something that's not very like, you know, you like doing it. It's not, I mean, yeah, you can to profit off of it, obviously, but it's more like you still enjoy doing it so much. And also like your kids' faces too. Like you get to hang out with your kids all the time and really get to see them go crazy when you guys are playing a game together. I mean, I don't think a lot of people really understand like Dungeons and Dragons is fun. And it's fun to do with your friends. I can understand that. But playing a board game and connecting with your family and really becoming bonded in the experience is truly amazing. Like playing Monopoly, when someone goes bankrupt, it is the biggest sense of power you've ever had. Like, it's like, hi, you just went bankrupt. He goes, well, you're grounded. It's like, I don't care. You just lost Monopoly. And then you just start walking up the stairs while flicking them off slowly. like those are the best experiences. I mean, it really crafts out. I mean, recently, I decided to strike up a game of Monopoly. I remember my buddy was just like, what are we doing, dude? Like, you know what we could be doing right now? Like, we could be playing a game, watching a movie, doing something completely different, but a board game. I'm like, yeah, man. And I'm talking about old school Monopoly. None of the credit card shit. The credit card that's the worst one I've ever played in my entire life. You want to know anxiety from playing a board game. You're sitting there trying to remember how many payments, and then everything's in millions of dollars. So you're sitting there like, I just spent $40 million on what? A cashmere sweater? Like, it's playing the old original one was so much fun. You had people fighting over who wanted to be the shoe, who wanted to be the dog, who wanted to be the car. I'm like, this is where true experiences and memories are made.
And there's nothing like holding just a wad of cash money in your hand, even if it's pink and yellow and green thing. Like, man, I am, that guy just stepped on Boardwalk and I am flush now.
Yeah. Or if you get $200 for pass and go. Yeah.
Well, you know, take what you can get.
And I never understood free parking.
That's, I believe I don't either, but from what I understand, just a homebrew thing that people added onto there.
Yeah, I really felt like everybody just started making their own rules at one point. And they're like, did anybody actually read the directions? It's like, oh, wait a minute. When you hit free parking, nothing happens. They're like, oh, I thought you collected all the money in the middle. I'm like, no, that's just some bullshit you made up.
I mean, you don't get $200 and something bad doesn't happen. But it's always like, it's not really anybody read the rules. It's, yeah, man, my brother taught me how to play, or my cousin taught me how to play, and this is how he did it. This is how the rules go.
See, I think Monopoly taught more kids or like generations of what the real world was going to be like compared to what school did. Like, school never taught me how to balance my checkbook. Monopoly told me that there's a thing called tax and we got to pay it. So like, that was pretty important. I mean, besides telling me quicksand was going to be a major problem in my life, and I still have never ran into it until I actually podcasted with a person from Brazil or something. He was talking about how big of quicksand was down there, and I was like, oh shit, I did not realize there was this actual issue out there for some people.
Yeah, and playing Monopoly, it teaches you that, you know, hey, you might want to save some money back for rent, you know, because when you land on that square and you don't have any money, you're out. You're not.
It's probably good to have a safety net at one point. You know what I mean? It just too much benefits to that game. But when it comes to creating your own kind of figures in a way too, like how often, like, do you get commissioned to go do a certain piece or anything? Do you have people that come to you and ask for something to get made? I mean, I was staring at one that was a horse, looked like something that could be mounted so you could place a character inside of it. Like, that doesn't look like it took a quick amount of time. That looked like it kind of spent a couple day process doing so.
Yeah, I haven't had any real commissions yet, but I'm just kind of doing whatever I'm kind of inspired to make. I really like using horses because I grew up around them and I understand them really well. And I just thought, man, you know, rather than have a whole miniature where you have your character on a horse and you have your horse, and rather than having four different miniatures, you could have just, here's your horse and you get it on and you can get off and your horse can run away, or somebody can knock you off your horse and take your horse, or you could take the bad guy's horse. And again, rather than having to paint one or sculpt one or put one together, you can just print this one out, you know, cut it out, glue it together, and there you go.
Now, does this cause you to turn to any types of new forms of technology to be able to create these a little bit faster instead of doing it the old hand style way? You can do like, I know they have 3D printers and stuff that could probably benefit you a lot in this instance.
They do. And there are a lot of guys that make a lot of really good stuff. I just really enjoy the process of working with paper and folding it and just kind of figuring out what kind of nails I can pound with my paper hammer.
I do have to ask though, how often do you get paper cuts?
I do not. I don't get that many, mainly because I'm also a horseshoer in addition to my other day job. So I've got, my hands are pretty hard to cut. But then we don't use actual, letter paper. We use cardstock, which is quite a bit thicker. I use a hobby knife, and there have been times when I've been cutting out miniatures, and I have cut myself, or it gets real when you're cutting out miniatures, because I'll print off a bunch of my own, because I put out a lot of different variant styles, like with different colors, one might be holding a different sword, which means I have a lot to cut out, which I enjoy because it's very meditative, but sometimes I'll fall asleep doing it. A couple times I stab myself right through the finger.
How often do you have family game night? I have to ask, because I'm like, if you're doing this and you guys don't have a game night, then there's something wrong.
Oh, every week.
What do your kids typically enjoy about it?
My daughter enjoys setting things on fire and spreading mayhem. my son enjoys being kind of a mastermind and always having a plan. His plans don't usually work that often, but he always has a plan.
It's always funny because I remember listening to my dad say, like, when we were playing kind of family games back in the day, he was like, you guys are your own. Like, it's literally like watching, like, you have one kid and then you have another kid, and you literally get to see how they're completely different. You think they're going to be the exact same, so you know how to handle the second one when it does arrive. And he's like, you're nothing like your brother. I'm like, why? He's like, all you do is buy every single property you land on. So then whenever we start moving, you're broke in the beginning, but towards the end, you have everybody's money. I'm like, yep. My brother just sits patiently on his money and just sits there and waits until like the right properties open up, or the ones he wants specifically open up. And it's really where you get to see how your kids are going to determine out in life. Like, oh, you're going to be very, very beneficial with your savings, and you are going to be buying every Gucci purse you come across.
That's one of the things I like most about gaming is I enjoy the crafting aspect and the making stuff for it, but it's the storytelling aspect of it that I enjoy, because it's just you're all sitting there together and you're telling a story together. Each one of you is a character. One of you is kind of like the facilitator who's describing what things you encounter. And I think people just really enjoy telling stories, and that's why D&D has had such a rise in popularity, as well as podcasts. People like listening to podcasts because it's people talking to each other. Telling stories about their day, telling stories about what they do for a living, or even if it's just, describing history, or
it's the fantasy aspect, man. There's something. See, storytelling podcasts are really popular in Australia for some reason. In America, I think some of the most popular podcasts are probably true crime, just because mm-hmm. we all have that need to know, like watch a killer or something like that. We want to kind of hear all the steps, but that's still a story. But when we look at Dungeons and Dragons, like crafting out a story, that was always so fascinating with me, which is the only reason why I would want to play Dungeons and Dragons, just randomly being the dungeon master and being like, there's a school of orcs coming up ahead of you. What are you going to do? You only have a small dagger. Then it's like you immediately create this scenario where you're like, oh, shit, I have to think on my feet now.
Well, that's like you never know what the players are going to throw at you. And you could have even think, I have this whole dungeon. I want them to go to this area. I have this all planned out perfectly well. There's no way. This is the story I want to tell. And then when my daughter was about five, they were traveling. She was playing a wizard. My son was playing a robot with a cannon strapped to his head. And they were walking through these caves. And I says, well, I don't want them to go. And the map had this branching area. And one went one way I wanted them to go. And the other one, I was going to put a whole family owl bears, which are these giant. It's like a grizzly bear with an owl head. They're terrifying and they're hard to defeat. And so you come across and there's a family owl bears. And my daughter, she's five at the time. She says, how high is the ceiling? Like, I don't know, 50 feet. Like, are there any of those rock sticky things sticking out of it? Like, what do you mean, stalactites? Yeah, there's sure. There's some up there. Okay, I'm going to cast Fountain of Flame at the base of those. Like, all right. And says, so lava is going to fall out of the ceiling onto these owl bears. Like, okay, well, that does this damage. Well, then, since I did it at the base of the stalactites, that's going to drop all the stalactites on them and impale them all. Like, oh, wow. My five-year-old's using three-dimensional physics to kill these things. It's like, okay, yeah, you guys.
Holy shit. Like, all right, I learned that in a different way. I did not learn that. I think she probably discovered that from playing so many video games and stuff. You'd probably be able to figure that out now. But for probably. Me, I learned that from pool. My grandma was like, hey, you want to play some pool? I'm like, sure. So we're sitting at this restaurant and I'm like, wow, pool is just a basic game of like geometry, hitting angles and things. She whooped my ass, dude. I have never been beaten so bad in like six game of pool in a row. And I was like, I don't know how I lost. Like, I'm so much like younger. I'm spryer. I'm able to, you know, I'm in school. I know geometry and stuff. And she's like, you know, I used to be an ex-professional pool champion, right? I was like, oh, so you basically hustled my ass. And she goes, yeah, basically. I'm like, okay, makes sense. But like, that was the first thing when you were describing that scenario. The first thing I thought of was, I was like, if there's a cannon on my head, I can definitely aim up at something inside of a cave. Usually there's stalactites or stalagmites in there. I can drop down and impale things, completely just knock everything out of the way.
Well, my son was only 3 at the time, so he didn't have quite the tactical know-how that my 5-year-old did.
I'm telling you, that's some tactical know-how, though, being able to figure that out. Holy crap. If I was at 5 and thought of that, I don't know where I would be today. I'd probably start designing a lot of things. This is where I say Minecraft's a major benefit because it teaches kids
so much. Oh, yeah.
Now, when you're crafting out a story, do you try and do it Dungeon Master style, kind of just how Dungeons & Dragons does, where you kind of like just create a scene or create something that they can get immersed in, and then the problems or whatever, a person that can kind of take hold of their own with their own imagination, I think is what makes it such a benefit. It's literally like Mad Libs. Like, you create the basis and then people fill in their answers.
Yeah, I don't like to have a full set out story, because typically when you have a whole story that you have laid out exactly where you want it to go, the players end up going the exact opposite way. So I just kind of have, here's 3 options they can go. Here's 3 options they can take, or here's, you know, 3 different places they can go. I kind of have a vague idea of what will happen if they go to each of these places, but I try to keep it fairly basic and outlined so I can improv it as I need to.
It's like a false startup to that show, Family, Wheel of Fortune, where they're like, behind curtain number 1, like you have all the amazing presents behind curtain number 1, and then you have nothing behind 2 and 3 because you know the person's going to pick number 1. And then you read off number 1, then some dude picks number 2. You're like, are you sure you don't want number 1? And the guy's like, no, I want number 2. He goes, he wants number 1. And then you point at it. I'd see with the crafting out the story part, like, what do you try and stick with the most? Like, everybody's kind of got like a template, you know, that they try to work off of. Now, we talked about like your inspiration, kind of like you like ranching in a way too. Do you try and stick a lot of your stuff around old school themes, or do you try and go futuristic with it?
I stay mostly old school. I enjoy Star Trek, and I play a couple of Star Trek based games that I play, or, you know, Star Wars and stuff like that. For the most part, I stay fantasy. I kind of keep the style of each adventure is kind of the lone rider comes into town and has a problem to solve and takes care of it. And I try to keep it kind of episodic like that, with, you know, there's a bad guy, or there's a gang that needs to be dealt with, or there's, you know, some sort of threat, and just let the players kind of figure out how they want to deal with that threat or join that threat. Heck, you know, you never know.
Yeah, most movies have a protagonist and antagonist too. That's kind of the basis of the template for the stories of most of it. I always found it fascinating. You ever see that movie Ballad of Buster Scruggs?
Ballad of Buster. Yep, I've seen it.
That movie, the first scene is fucking insane. You want to talk about I love the Coen brothers. Their twists on things is so amazing. But like, that was what everyone would think it was like. Like, they thought it was going to be this guy coming in, unstoppable force, going against the biggest, baddest enemies and taking them all down and not dying. And then he meets somebody, gets shot. And then it's like, what just happened? Like, everyone's completely thrown off guard. That's what I find the best, when you're able to recreate that into a board game as well. Like, if you're able to keep everyone on their feet all the time, you know, I've heard people that play Dungeons and Dragons and creating a story where they try and get their buddies immense to it. Because honestly, you're going to, out of the group of friends that you have that end up playing it, you're going to have people that are way more into it than others, just on the basis of the day. Hopefully your dungeon master's more into it than, I guess, someone else that's just playing the game, because the dungeon master can be like, oh, good job, you made it to the end. All right, I got to piss. And then just gets up and walks away. You're like, what? Like, we just spent 6 hours playing this game and you want to end it now because you have to pee? Like, we can take a break. But,
yeah, you usually have a couple of players that aren't as into it. They just kind of enjoy the social aspect of it, to hanging out. But usually, yeah, the guy running the game is usually the one that's most into it, because he's the one that buys all the books.
Now, where do you plan on taking this? Are you trying to develop your own company, like where you can maybe design your own game shop? I mean, I saw that being pretty popular, only because, like, you have an online website for people to buy stuff, but it's like, I don't know what it was. I went to a mall one time, and this is when HeroScape was becoming popular, and they had all the figurines and all the casings and everything, and I realized there was this whole culture for it. Like, we're talking about being visual learners, like being able to go somewhere and actually buy the stuff. There's no better feeling, too, and it's a cool aspect, too, to dive into something new, like a hobby.
Yeah, I don't really, I'm not really interested in opening up a store or doing retail. I mainly just enjoy doing what I'm doing, where I can make miniatures and I can sell them online. Having an actual brick and mortar store, it would be a lot more stress than I'd want to deal with. But I enjoy just selling stuff online, putting some miniatures that somebody can print off the internet and then just print them and then put them together at home. There's a couple products I want to put out, like I'm working on developing I'm calling it the emergency DM kit, where it's everything you need to run a game, but it's in a little tin the size of an Altoids can. Like, it's got a screen, it's got dice, it's got miniatures, it's got maps, it's got a little adventure book, it's got character sheets. It's all kind of small, but that way, if you're stuck at the airport for 3 hours, or you're out camping and it's raining outside and you can't leave your tent, you have everything you need that you can fit in your pocket to just run a game right there.
Now, what's common with most people that play role-playing games, they also have a fascination to do live-action role-play. I don't know if you ever heard of LARPing.
Oh, yeah.
Do you LARP, my friend?
I have not LARPed. I would try LARPing, but I have not had the opportunity yet.
That's what I'm saying.
I'm not going to be a LARP leader.
I don't know why my friends make fun of me for wanting to LARP. I'm like, there's just something that looks so bad. Like, what's more badass than acting like a knight and like being able to fight somebody with a foam sword? Like, you practically are literally beating the shit out of each other, but you're not going to get arrested for assault because both parties are in agreement.
Well, I mean, I go outside the yard and me and my kids chase each other with foam swords and sticks. And I don't know, is that LARPing? I don't know.
Technically it is. But I mean, like dressing up like an actual character from the thing. Like, you ever seen the movie Role Models?
Oh, yeah. Where they all dress as Kiss. Yeah.
And like Paul Rudd's sitting with his hands tied behind a light post. And he actually looks like he's tied up. And then the car rolls up. He was just doing an imaginary and jumps right into the car. I'm like, that's so much fun, though. Like, I get it. Like, I get why people are interested in that. I never understood, but it's something. If you're able to recreate that into your own life, I think what makes board games and video games popular in general is it's an escape from reality. Sometimes you just don't want to be yourself. Like, everyone talks about cosplay and how like it's weird or, you know, something like that. But I'm like, if you truly try and understand it, it's a bunch of people dressing like a character that they idolize that put so much time and effort into it. And they're comfortable because they're around other people that think in the exact same way. Like, if you ever get into barbecuing, if you join a barbecuing group, you realize that everyone is thinking just like you, how positive the effect is. If you join a board game or a certain club or a store or something like a comic book store, when you go there, you realize everybody's interested into the same thing, and it creates such a better environment where you don't feel like an outcast.
Yeah, and you can build each other up. You can help each other in areas that you struggle with, and, you know, you can just give each other encouragement. And that's with the other paper miniature artists that I'm friends with. We have our own Discord server that we all chat with each other on. We put up our art, you know, we critique each other's art and point out areas where it can be improved, and just, you know, you help each other out. And I mean, a rising tide raises all ships. You know, if you want to just stick by yourself and avoid everyone, you're not going to get any better unless you have someone there to help you or to challenge you.
Now, what plans do you have for doing this into the future? Like, anything besides maybe the mechanical dragon that you're talking about creating, or maybe those products you were mentioning? Is there anything that's super on your mind that you feel like is going to take a little bit more time to kind of build up to?
I want to do maps. I want to make maps that I can put out for people. I want to make more rideable stuff, like, you know, griffins and, you know, giant boars and a lot more stuff like that. A little more, maybe some of vehicles like wagons or battle tanks or, you know, medieval battle tanks.
More sophisticated pieces.
Yeah, more complex, and make a simple version, because not everybody wants to put together something that complex. You know, have a simple version, have a more complex version. You know, airships. I want to make like floating islands that can stand on like clear stands. You know, you have your characters jump from island to island that's floating in the sky.
Oh, that's badass. Immediately, I thought of like, if you took one of those thin plastic like PVC pipe poles and you put it on like put one of those floating islands on that, and you can have them on different levels where they could be like lifts, so you could have your character move up. I mean, how many times you play a board game like Chutes and Ladders, it's still on the table. It's like, let's get the character actually up in the air, more visual. I think that would create a better kind of more people getting interested into the game rather than just sitting there like, oh, I'm down the ladder.
Oh, totally.
Like Mouse and Trap or a Cat and Mouse game, the one where you had to build up the trap. And that was a pain in the ass to set up, but let me tell you, it was fun as hell.
You know, I never once actually played the game. We would always just set the mouse trap up and just activate it. We would never actually play the actual game for it.
I remember I would spend probably 25 minutes each time trying to build that up. I don't even, from when I was like 4 all the way up until I was like 16, it still took me forever. And they're like, why don't you just read the directions so you know how to do it right? I'm like, because I don't need to read the directions.
Yeah,
I'm a man. I can assemble a board game that's fit for kids ages 6 and up and 99 and down. Like, yeah, but it's taking you 25 minutes. I don't really want to play anymore. Well, you know what? Patience. Patience. Okay. Good things come to those who wait. We're going to play a game that has a cat and a mouse, and someone's getting caught under the fucking trap. Yeah, but like, have you ever decided to get interested in chess? Like, I always thought that game was the most tasking thing in the world. And then I saw Harry Potter, and then I got a chess board. I know that's two dramatically different scenarios, but I was like, oh, this is what wizards do. They play chess. And I don't know why I took that leap, but it just immediately in my brain, they connected the two. Chess was
one thing that bothered me about the Harry Potter chess was it was just regular chess. It wasn't like, I would think that these wizards that can do all kinds of crazy stuff, they would have some kind of three-dimensional, upside down. What's that guy that has the painting with all the weird stairways going up? M.C. Escher, like an M.C. Escher painting.
Yeah, where, the one that literally gives you your mind, especially when they include it into a cartoon. I know they did it with Scooby-Doo at one point. That was so confusing for me as a child. He went one way and then he was upside down. I was like, okay.
Or like in Labyrinth.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if Harry Potter, like chess, first of all, like the cool thing I thought about that was just the idea that they were live chess pieces. So like the actual characters, when they got close, they would move and like attack and shatter the other piece. That was so interesting to me. And I mean, at one point,
you remember that? You remember that wizard or that chess game from Windows 95, where that when you it was called Battle Chess, where when your chess pieces got to each other, they would actually have a little animated fight on the screen.
Oh, no, I don't remember that, but I think I kind of remember like somebody playing that in my household though.
Oh yeah, that thing was cool.
See, what I thought was really interesting, like what really scared me off of board games was that fucking game Jumanji. Like that was a big thing for board games too. Like, you know how popular that game was, and then it just got brought back. Like board games, like now they kind of turned it into like the new Jumanji's, like you're going into a video game and stuff. But
yep,
that was a really classic game. I mean, I go to thrift stores and I'll randomly find a board game and I'll grab it and play, because I mean, you know how fun it is just to be able to kind of sit down and like just shoot the shit. Like time flies, man. Like,
yep.
I mean, playing from, like, I like card games too, you know, not solitaire or anything. I still think if you play solitaire, there's probably something wrong with you. but like just playing Crazy Eights. I mean, I played Crazy Eights for 6 hours on one game one time.
Wow.
Like 6 hours playing a fucking card game. Like at that point, literally my dad was like, here you go. Bam, done. You win. I'm done. I need to smoke. I need to do this. This is bullshit. We've been playing for 6 hours. Like, why would you end it? It could keep on going. He's like, nobody's going to win. We've been in the hotel room playing for 6 hours. I'm like, yeah, man. But now we have a story to tell.
Well, I mean, I think with the rise of, with the way board games and, you know, card games and stuff like that is developed so much lately, is people just feel, they feel isolated. They have so many things to occupy their time that it just seems silly. They're like, well, I'm going to schedule time to go talk with somebody, or I'm going to schedule time. If you have a game, which is the focus of the game, and the side benefit is you get to interact with all these people and you get to have fun with them and have conversations where you don't feel like, well, you know, I'm just wasting time bullshitting with someone. Well, you know, you're not. We're playing this game. This is what we have scheduled to do. And it kind of gives you an excuse to socialize, which makes you feel less like you're wasting time. You actually have an end goal, which the goal is to interact and to socialize, but you can tell people like, oh no, we're playing our game. We're not just hanging out.
Yeah, well, even when you're playing like something like Dungeons and Dragons too. The weird part about a store that sells the miniature figures and all that, like everything that you can get for the game, is the fact is you're going to have people that come across there that just want to buy the collectibles and have them standing around in their room or something. Like, I think that's become pretty popular too with like action figures, instead of playing with them, just having them kind of set up, like Funko Pops, for instance. That became huge when it first started, still is today. I mean, there's so many different combinations of them now, but like people just love looking at that stuff and collecting stuff. Like, I remember playing Bakugan back in the day, which a lot of people barely remember, but I went, like, I had a bunch of them. They were sold away from me. And then I went to every single thrift store and I found like 100 of them in one jug, dude. And whoever's mom threw that out, and whoever the kid was, I'm sorry. I know you're probably really pissed off that she did that, because now I literally said they're going to make a comeback and now they're in Walmarts everywhere. Like $20.
Those are the little plastic ones. When you roll them, they transform into something.
Yes. That is so badass.
Oh yeah. Those are cool. Yeah.
Like, that's just like, I have a bunch of them. I just sit there and open it up like right next to my computer or something. Just like over and over and over again, just watching something turn into something. It's why Bionicles were so popular. You like seeing kind of create and form in front of you. It's like, why people love building models. It's like just the process of it too. I know, oh my God, what is that thing? Gundams.
Mm-hmm.
Those are so big. Like, people are spending hundreds and hundreds of dollars just buying the Japanese sets for them, being able to create these model figures out of glue and stuff. Like, I have so many miniature figures just kind of lined up across my shelf or something, just because they're interesting to look at. I think it's more of enjoying it from an artist aspect as well.
Yep. Yeah, you can appreciate the work that went into making it, especially something small like that and complex. Or like with a transformer, like the thought and the engineering that had to go into making something that can go from one shape into another shape and not, you know, immediately fall apart and hold its form.
Yeah, Transformers, that was a big one for me too. I really liked watching something change. I found it really, really hard trying to work with the action figures though, mostly because it's like, once I got it to transform, I was like, how do I get it to go back? And I'm sitting there for like 2 hours trying to bring them back into a car. And then once I got them back into a car, I was like, you know how long that took me to bring them into a car? I'm definitely not going to transform back. 2 seconds later, I transform them back. I'm like, shit, I got to put them back.
The awkward part was when we were kids and we watched the cartoon and we tried to transform them as fast as they did in the cartoon, because they always made the sound, you know, when they transformed. And that was the challenge, is to try and transform it in the time it took you to make the sound.
Bro, you can't just say the sound. You got to be like... like that. Yeah. Whenever
we're doing awful.
it's like a transformer that's like just like a little bit, like it's the last one that gets picked for dodgeball. That was our transformation. But when we're talking about kind of creating and going here and all this type of stuff, like, how did you decide to name the company Tear Table Game? Or is it Terrible? Like, you spelled it wrong. So I'm wondering, my brain wants to say Tear Table, but there's not another T in there.
Well, it's terrible because they're made out of paper.
Holy shit.
Yeah, I did not actually come up with that. A friend of mine on Twitter, he's good at naming stuff. So I says, listen, man, you got to help me come up with a cool name for this company. Like, what about, he came up with a couple and I was like, yeah, those are all right. And what about Tearable Monsters? You can go with the wordplay. They're made out of paper. I thought that is too brilliant not to use.
I can't believe I just got that.
It took me a little bit when he initially told me, like, that's not spelled right. Like, oh,
wow.
Wait.
That's actually really, really good name. Hold on. Audience, I'm sorry. You're going to have to give me a minute on this one. It's like when you find out if you add melted cheese onto anything, it immediately makes your whole life change forever.
My buddy Dan broke your brain.
Yes, he did. It's like when someone says, is there a Jack who? Jack Normus? I don't know. Is there a Jack Enormous? Oh, you son of a, like, you know, that whole thing. That's literally what just happened to me. Wow. All right. That's a good name too. And now what do you typically find that a lot of people really trying to prioritize out of all the stuff you make? Like, what's one of your top best sellers?
The Oozes are the newest one. They've gotten a lot of interest. I did some Slad, which are like these toad-like creatures that come from this realm of utter chaos. And nobody's really put out any miniatures of them. And they were pretty popular. Did some Chain Devils, which are these like S&M demons that just can control chains with their mind, like in Hellraiser, and they were pretty popular.
You know, one thing I really found interesting, like scrolling kind of through your Instagram too, was the fact that you had them on cakes and stuff. Like, that was a big thing when I was a kid. Like, you went to Johnny's party and Johnny had a birthday candles and shit and the classic stuff. And then you had your birthday party and someone put those little figures on top of your cake, man. Like, you were the badass. Like, I want the piece with the toad on it. No, that's going to be his piece because he's the birthday boy. No, but I want it. And then the kids were fighting afterwards for it. Like, that has a whole nother thing too. You could end up working with a bakery and being able to sell that to bakers to put on their cakes. You know how hard it is for them after they bake a cake to try and create something like from Fortnite? You could easily make a paper mache thing and put on top, just like we have on a wedding cake, a man and a woman on the top of the cake or whatever you want to put on top of your cake. Like, that's popular. Why don't we do that with regular cakes?
That's a great idea.
Bam. I am marketing already.
My wife, she actually has a marketing degree, and that was her idea, was to do, because we have a game night every week. We do a 1 week with the kids and then 1 week with friends. Then we stick in, you know, an extra game night a week with just our kids. But my wife's like, people like food pictures, and this way you can actually put your miniatures on there, because people are gonna like, if there's food on there, people are gonna like it, because that's what's all on Instagram. And we call her the snack wizard. She makes all the snacks.
You just got to make sure you warn them that they got to take it off before they eat it. Because I did make that mistake a lot of times. Like, people put stuff on top of cakes, like the candle and stuff. Like, you ate the candle. I'm like, was it not digestible? Like, is that not, like, they probably have a better way of doing it now. But I made that mistake way too many times when I was a kid. It might have ended up actually causing some damage later in life.
They have printable ink. I wonder if you could put it on fondant, and that way you could have an edible miniature.
Oh, that's interesting. Now, I also have been tricked, too, because I know I ordered a cheesesteak from this restaurant called Ponzetti's one time. And you know how they have the toothpick swords inside of the sandwich?
Yep.
This thing was fucking invisible, I swear. I'm not an idiot. I didn't see it. I bit straight into this cheesesteak and toothpick into the bottom of my mouth and into the top of my mouth. That kept my mouth from closing down. And for some reason, at this instance in my life, I was with a couple of my friends, and I guess everybody else was too lazy to order something. So the woman asked me first, was like, what would you like? I'm like, can I get a cheesesteak sub with french fries, black pepper, lettuce and tomato on the cheesesteak? That's it. And she's like, okay, then what would you like? Then all my friends just ordered the same exact thing as me. And I bit into it, and I'm the one that gets a punctured roof in the mouth. And they all go, oh, wow, I didn't even see the sword. And they all take it out. I'm like, well, fuck you guys.
You're the mind canary.
Well, I really appreciate you coming out, Paul, and being able to do the podcast too, man.
No problem, man. Glad to do it.
I really want to give you here a minute at the end to kind of promote your content too, where people can find your awesome works and look at your figurines too. I mean, they're really amazing too, and they add a whole nother layer to board games in general. I do have to ask before you do say that though, what do you think about Ouija boards, and why are they selling them in Toys R Us?
I don't even know, man. I grew up in a evangelical household, so I'm still scared of that stuff.
I know that was a big thing. Like, literally, I would not want to take the risk of finding out if Johnny wants to sleep with me after the sleepover just to be able to summon a demon. I'm sorry, that just doesn't cross my mind. But I walked into Toys R Us and they had a Ouija board. I was like, you have to be above the age of 6 to play the Ouija board. So you have to be above the age of 6 and below the age of 99 to be able to summon the devil. Like, it doesn't make any sense to me.
I don't know. I just keep it at arm's length.
All right. Well, why don't you share us your link so we can be able to find your content?
Sounds good. You can find, you can get a hold of my Patreon. It's at tearablemonsters.com. That's T-E-A-R-A-B-L-E, as in terrible, which we discussed. And then I'm also on Instagram as Tearable Monsters, Twitter is Tearable Monster, and you know, Facebook. I'm on pretty much everything. I try to make an account for at least every outlet that I could.
Well, there you go. And do you want to take us out? I know you got to be involved in making a board game, so you got to be able to craft a story that's going to be able to be like an outro. So how would you take us out? You do it in a mystical way. I like mystical things. So if you throw me back into 18th century and we're fighting a dragon or something, I like that. And
oh, man. As the two heroes finish their palaver, they looked into each other's eyes and knew what they must do. They had to slay the great beast that stood before them. They drew their swords and leapt towards the portal, towards it into adventure.
I really love that ending, and that was on the spot. And dude, that was really good. I always wondered, though, like when you get to see like a hero fighting a dragon, if there's just some dude in the background, like, should I help? Like, should I? Like, do I really want to risk dying, or should I just see how this turns out? Maybe if he dies, I can grab all of this shit.
That's usually my daughter's play style.
I'm telling you, man, it's the best. If you see a dude fighting a dragon and his shirt's off, and then you see a chick off to the side, you're just going to wait for that dude to die and then snag the chick. It's what I call the real He-Man.
There you go.
All right. Well, thanks for listening to this episode of Out of the Blank Podcast, and stay tuned for our next episode.